Hey, FedHeads, welcome to another episode of Sharing Our Pairings. This is episode 50. It's a celebration, FedHeads. We've been doing 50 of these shows. This is actually our second year. I'm your host, John the Cigar Surgeon. We're broadcast live on CigarFederation.com, picked up by the Armed Forces Radio Network all around the world. And of course, all you podcast listeners from Israel to Sweden, from North Korea to South Korea, from South Korea to Australia. Appreciate you listening in wherever you're listening in. We're going to be doing some interesting stuff tonight. I'm joined, as always, by my co-host, Robbie Rass. Rob, what's going on, brother?
I'm just happy to be smoking a cigar again. We have listeners in North Korea?
I don't know. It's one of the republics.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, I don't know. It seems like they'd have pretty strict guidelines as to what you could listen to. I have no idea.
I think Kim Il likes whiskey and cigars.
Oh, he's down. He's down to smoke some cigars. No. I've been on the shelf, as I said, for a few weeks, so it's nice to get be firing up a cigar again. And good thing we didn't go with anything strong.
Yeah, it's a good thing we went with something light to medium.
Yeah.
So for those of you tuning in, we're smoking some Aromacraft. I'm smoking the Cro-Magnon Aquitaine Cranium, which is listed as full plus. And it's a super full-bodied cigar, but you know, my thinking was we're drinking some crazy whiskeys, the highest of which is, I think, what is it, 66.7% ABV?
66 point something or other. It's
66.3% ABV, which is well above the normal 40% or 43% you drink typical whiskey or scotch at. So yeah, we're going crazy for our celebratory episode.
Yeah, exactly. I'm smoking an Aquitaine as well. I'm going with the Mode 5, which was just a slightly different Vitola. great cigar. I posted this up on Instagram, and within a few seconds, even though he's on vacation in Europe, Skip says that Aromacraft pairs better with bourbon than it does with scotch. So thanks, Skip.
Although that's an important safety tip for our episode, isn't it?
Although he did link to the at Aromacraft Instagram account, which is not theirs. So there's that. I think we're even. If I compare with Scotch, then he can link to an Instagram account that's not his own. So there you go.
Pair what you like and like what you pair.
Absolutely. No, this is definitely a heater, man. And like I said, I haven't smoked in a while, so... jumping right back in with both feet. Lots of pepper up front on the tongue, big time.
Tons, just a blast.
But there's a lot of nice flavors in there as well. My palate's still coming around, I'm a little bit off, but not that I had a good palate to begin with. But this is the regular Cro-Magnon Mode 5 is probably my favorite cigar that Skip makes. And this is actually the first time I've had the Aquitaine Mode 5, so... curious to see how this performs, and I think that these scotches are going to, especially what you're drinking, you're going far more on the peaty end than I am. But you're freezing and the wind's whipping around, so let's get started.
Yeah, a little bit about the Aquitaine before we kick off here, because you got to give some love to the cigar. So it's got an Ecuador Habano Ligero wrapper, because got to have that Ligero sun. And just because it's the theme of our show, or seemed to be the theme of our show this year, it's got a Cameroon binder. Oh, yeah, Cameroon goes with everything. And then the filler is really interesting. It's Nicaraguan, but skips us on the website. Go to aromacraft.com, by the way. Check it out. The filler leaf for this blend was acquired from three separate growing regions in Nicaragua, from Esteli, Condega, and then a small farm north of Esteli on the Honduran border, Pueblo Nuevo. I'm smoking the 6x54 Gran Toro with an MSRP of $8.25. And just before we get started, these are super full body, but you can be full bodied and have lots of flavor. And I think, you know, Skip's got a great palate, and he doesn't blend for strength. He blends for profile, and the strength comes along with it. And I appreciate that.
Yeah, absolutely. That's one of the things that Aromacraft is synonymous with strong cigars. But they've also got a ton of flavor in there. It's not strong just to be strong. The strength, you know, plays its part. I'm smoking the Mode 5, which is a 5x50 short perfecto, MSRP around $7. And the MSRP on their cigars is always great. I know they did that craft series, are a little bit pricier, but for the most part, their pricing is really, really nice. And this, God, the Aquitaine comes in one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, unless I'm missing some, 11 different Vitolas. And I actually have one of those Adel-Adels floating around. That's the Lancero. That would have been an interesting choice tonight. Maybe we'll do that for another show. But yeah, the stuff from Rummercraft is a big, big hit. Everybody on Cigar Federation is always talking about it. I know Stefan is actually one of our more active members, probably watching the show tonight. And he posted his own personal top 15 or top 10 for the year.
Nice.
And this is just one of our members. He's not a moderator or a writer for Cigar Federation, but he's very involved. And the Rummercraft Neanderthal was his number one cigar of the year. So there you go.
There you go. So what are we drinking tonight? Well, we're drinking some really unique stuff. I shouldn't say really unique because something can't be really unique. It is either unique or not. some unique whiskeys from the Scotch and Malt Whiskey Society, which boasts the world's largest selection of single cask, single malt whiskeys. What does that mean? Well, normally when you buy a single malt whiskey, it means it comes from a single distillery. That is, the distillery uses its own whiskey maltings. It doesn't mix in with other maltings from other distilleries, which you can get in blended whiskey, for example. What does single cask mean? Well, most releases are not single cask. So a distillery puts out a whiskey, they're looking to blend for a particular flavor that everyone's used to. So consistently, if you have a Laphroaig cork cask or Laphroaig 10, they're trying to make that whiskey consistent year over year. It's got to be the same flavor because that's what people are buying. In this case, these are single casks. So that means that the Scotch and Malt Whiskey Society has gone through the warehouse, they've picked a cask that they think is exceptional, and they bought the entire cask, and then they've had it bottled. Now, because of the way the Scotch rules work in Scotland, you can't have the distillery name on the bottle because they're not the ones that are bottling it. So you'll see numeric codes, and we'll talk a little bit about that as we go. I've been a member of the Scotch and Malt Whiskey Society for some time. I've got one or two bottles. I'm just going to hop right in with my first choice to give you a sense of where we're going tonight. This is from the Isle of Jura. This is 31.27 Bold Sailor's Dram. It was distilled in September of 1988. It is a 750ml bottle. I don't know how many freedom gallons that is, but doesn't matter. This is a 25-year-old whiskey, so that's how we're rolling here on our 50th episode. The cask type, it was a refill bourbon hogshead. So that's a bourbon cask that's been refilled, so it's not a first fill. And the region is Highland, but it is lightly peated. If you've ever heard of the Isle of Jura, it's just a tiny, tiny little whiskey producing area, but they have some really interesting stuff. And I'm going to take some sips while Rob talks about his first whiskey here.
So I'm starting off with, and again, these are all courtesy of your host, the cigar surgeon. so I'm tasting all this stuff, at his courtesy. So thank you for that, John. I appreciate it. I'm starting with number 125.67, and this is called Clean and Innocent. So as you can see, John started me off a little bit lower. The drinking tip, this could turn a lazy Sunday into a perfect lazy Sunday, so there you go. This was distilled in July of 1999. The color is Innocent Blonde. You gotta like that. I love a good Innocent Blonde. Yes, there you go.
Hey-o.
I don't know if the color really translates, but pretty light in color. Innocent Blonde. It's 14 years, and it's a cask type first fill barrel. It's from the Highland Northern region, and the profile is juicy oak and vanilla. Age 14 years, like I said. What does outturn mean, John?
Outturn is when they take the whiskey and they have a tasting specifically for society members and invite only non-society members, and you get to taste it basically as a sample to determine whether you want to buy that bottle or not. Okay, they have monthly outturns.
Okay, so the outturn is 193, whatever that means. Nobody really cares about that, I guess. And the ABV on this is 58.7%. So even though this is clean and innocent and it is an innocent blonde, she's still got kind of an attitude at 58.7. There's a lot of different information here. There's things in the nose. They start talking about meringue and barley sugars and toffee and honey and creme brulee. and there's some woody references of tea chests and sawdust and coconut and polished Steinway. That's very specific. And there's a ton of info here. This is actually a really cool website. It's got a lot of information on these. I've snuck a few sips of this, and it is really, really nice. I have a feeling that the Aquitaine might blow this one out a little bit, but we'll see. We're doing these tests in the name of science.
In the name of science, pairing science, that is. So a little bit about what I'm tasting in the cigar. You know, there's a lot of broadleaf influence on the initial couple draws. So like some leather, some earth. Definitely tasting some of the Cameron influence because there's an underlying sweetness, but definitely being run over by a lot of the Esteli tobaccos, which tend to be quite prominent in terms of flavor profile for a filler. Off the whiskey, and I'll do my best to smell here in the cold, but it's actually smelling quite vanilla sweet, which you kind of expect from a bourbon cask. Now, because this is a refill, you're not going to get as much as that vanilla oaky that you would normally get from a bourbon, and that might actually run over the spirit in this case. I took a couple sips while Rob was talking about his whiskey, and I can tell you it's like it's a briny seawater, which I really like. But there's this underlying melon sweetness to it with maybe some heather. I mean, it's very lightly peated. Like the seawater, salty, briny runs over to me any peat that I would taste. And to be honest, it's a great pairing. The saltiness of this really brings out a lot of characteristics in the cigar. I mean, we talk about contrasting, I've lost my mind already and we just started. So in this case, it's definitely contrasting. The salt is an offset to the leather and the sweet Cameroon. I forgot to mention that the ABV of this bad boy is only 52.4% only. Again, normally whiskey you'd buy is 40 or 43. So these are all cask strength. They have not been watered down. They've gone straight from the cask into the bottle. First pairing is A-okay in my books. How's your first pairing going?
she's innocent, but she kind of snuck up on me a little bit. I took a few sips, like I said, before the show, and everything was fine. That first sip I took, I mean, it was a heater going down the throat and caught me a little off guard. I had to take a few sips of water. These are strong, strong drinks. And this is a strong cigar. I mean, we're going strength, strength, strength. For me, I'm getting a lot of similar flavors for you from the cigar. A lot of spice on the tongue, a lot of black pepper on the tongue. Earthy notes, kind of deep earthy notes with some of that leather influence in there. I am getting a little bit of chocolate out of it. And kind of an underlying sweetness like you were saying. Almost like a sweet cream in there a little bit, but a very, very nice cigar on the high end of my strength and spice enjoyment level. It's a little bit higher than I normally go. But when I'm in the mood for a good spicy cigar, and this is what we were talking about, we wanted to do a good spicy cigar with these whiskeys, and the first thing we thought of was Roma Craft. So notes that I'm getting from this clean and innocent number 125.67, I'm getting kind of like, they say elderflower in here, and vanilla, and orange blossom. There's some guava, mango, and peach, which is, I mean, these are a lot of different flavors, but I'm getting flavors in that range. Some kind of higher fruit notes, a little bit of citrus in there, but then a kind of an underlying sweeter layer of flavor, like that elderflower. It's got a little bit of, I mean, obviously it's got some sweetness to it, but it's also got almost like an herbal. Maybe herbal is not the right term, but like an herbal kind of flavor to it. If you've tasted elderflower, you know what I'm talking about. And that's really kind of what you smell on the nose too. There's a kind of a bright sweetness in there, not peated. It's smooth, even though that first sip kind of got me a little bit. As smooth as something that's what did we say 58%, almost 60% can be. Haven't added any water. I might here in a little bit just to see if that impacts it a little bit. But so far, the pairing is pretty nice.
Yeah, and we are definitely tasting, drinking, and pairing very, very strong beverages. And I think, you know, we learned over the year that you got to match strength to strength. You can't have something super delicate. And I think part of the reason that attracts me to single cask non-diluted whiskey is that you're getting the maximum character out of that cask. Now I know, you know, I've talked about adding water in the past, and you're certainly free to add water. This is definitely a drink where feel free to add water, because again, you know, we're drinking these at 10 or 15% above what a normal bottling would be. So there's lots of room to add water and see what character comes out. Now, am I going to add water to a 25-year-old whiskey that's full strength, full cask? Probably not, because I feel like that does a little bit of disservice, but it is a heater. You can't just go drinking a cask strength whiskey. You have to kind of let your palate acclimate a little bit, because it is a heater to start out with.
You know, it's interesting. While you were talking, I took a couple puffs and I took a couple sips, and I started getting more woody character out of the scotch, not just that higher fruit note and some of that sweetness, but I started getting a woody character out of there. And while you were talking, even though you said you're probably not going to add some water, I added just a little bit. I mean, I don't know, a couple drops of water just to kind of stimulate things. And it seemed to open. I mean, it opens up that flavor profile just a little bit. Everything kind of took a little bit of a step forward in there. And I've only taken one sip since I've done that, so I want to check it out one more time here after adding some water.
Just a reminder to audience, you are tuned into CigarFederation.com's Sharing Our Pairings. This is episode 50. It's a celebration, FedHeads. We're broadcasting around the world, picked up on the Armed Forces Radio Network. Hopefully some people out there get that reference. I can't say the other reference because we are keeping it clean for the Armed Forces Radio Network. Hope you guys are staying safe. Hope you had a great Christmas, and I hope you have a great and boring New Year's with no action, just a nice, relaxing barrack time. I'm going to move on to my second whiskey because we have a lot of whiskey to go through tonight. We might get a little silly. Might get a little gooned.
Gooned. Yeah. Just to go back one more time to this one, I added a little bit of water, significantly smoothed everything out. That's really the best way I can put it. The flavors are, I don't know if they're elevated or if they're just easier for me to detect now because everything's a bit smoother. it wasn't all that harsh to begin with, but just easing everything out just a little bit. Kind of smoothed out everything, and I don't know, everything became a bit richer in a sense. So far, so good. I mean, this pairing's pretty nice. It is bringing out some more of the leather and some more of the spice from the aquatine for me as we move forward as well.
I can see why Skip would suggest bourbon pairing, because, you know, although the cigar starts out with just a huge blast of pepper, if you can get over that pepper, it does become more elegant once you get past that first quarter inch of pepper. And I think, you know, the match here for bourbon is you've got that fruitiness, you've got the vanilla, you've got all that sweet characteristic, which does bring out a lot from the leather and the pepper that's in the cigar. So that seems to be a natural pairing, but we're going in a completely different direction because, hey, it's our show and we can do what we want. And if Skip wants to come on and correct us, Skip, you're invited anytime, brother. So I'm going on to number two because I'm a crazy man. This is 29.115 Candy Floss in Fairground. It sounds better than it is because this is Lafroy. For all the Lafroy lovers out there, this is a super peaty, and it's not even the peatiest whiskey I've got on the table today. So this was distilled in 1989. It is 22 years old. It is in a refill ex-sherry butt. Now that's what first attracted me. Is normally Lafroy would be in a bourbon butt, but a sherry butt is going to impart a whole range of fruity characteristics and you know, that island fruit, so like banana and coconut and that kind of melon fruit to the whiskey, which you really wouldn't get in Lafroy. And that's what really attracted me to this bottle when I first tasted it. So the 115 in this case refers to the number of casks. So this is 115th cask that they've turned out. So it's a lot of casks versus the last one, which is only the 27th cask. Makes sense because I'm surprised that Jura would allow so many single casks to be done. So of course, this is an Islay whiskey. It's peated. It is 55.8%, so we're going up. And I'm going to take some noses here while Robbie talks about his second whiskey.
I am going with this one they've referred to as the Cowboy's Delight.
I love that whiskey so much.
When you start, and just to put things into perspective, the whiskey that you're drinking now is the one that I'm drinking last. So I almost feel like my pairings might be a little bit better than where you're going to be, because you've got some serious peat action. So I'm curious to see how that works. This one here, the Cowboy's Delight, notes of polished leather, marinated pork, and a hint of dry tar. So I'm curious to, and burnt buttered toast. Those are very specific. sweet than savory. So that, I think that's probably just an easier way to put it. It's 27.104 is the cask number. Cowboys Glide is the name. 15 years old. It was distilled in May of 1998. The color is fun to say. Polished conkers. What is a conker, John? Do you know what a conker is?
I don't. Make sure to message our Q&A app here. If you know what a conker is, we'd love for you to check in.
Yeah.
Mine is the color of vibrant cadmium gold.
Okay.
Just hold that up. Cadmium gold, if you can see that there. And I would, you know, that's kind of a bright cadmium gold. I'd agree.
Absolutely. So a polished conker would be, you know, it's a deeper color. This is the darkest of all the whiskeys that I'm having tonight. So polished conkers, 15 years old when it was, or 15 years old. The cask type was a refill Gorda X Sherry. What's a Gorda?
That's just the cask size.
That's the size of the cask. That's what I figured as I was asking. Now, the region is Campbelltown. Now, I'm not really familiar with the Campbelltown region.
Are you? So, yeah, Campbelltown is on the west of Scotland, and they used to be one of the premium. I think at one time they were really this, you know, other than the Highlands, Campbelltown was like the number one producing region in all of Scotland. Now, not so much anymore, but and not to lead you in the tasting, but for me, Campbelltown whiskeys have this sort of coastal town, sea salt, fishy characteristic to them. And I'm a huge fan of Campbelltown whiskeys. And that whiskey that you're drinking there, I think I'm down to about half on that bottle because I just keep going back. It's such a great bottle.
And you actually gave me quite a little bit because this is the pour that I have today. And this is how much I have left. So you were quite generous. Now, I can definitely taste the leather in this. And as you were talking, the first thing that comes to mind while I'm tasting this is quite briny. It's got that kind of sea salt air down by the pier type flavor to it, which I actually enjoy. To find that done well, a nice briny, a nice briny scotch is something I do enjoy. So far, so good. It's almost got a creamy texture to it. Definitely very leathery, and there's some kind of that burnt wood in there. It's not peaty. But like a barbecue type flavor in there. And I could be just way off course, but this is what I'm getting so far. And after having two sips and a couple of puffs of the cigar while you were talking there briefly, I think this might be the pairing of the night for me.
So in terms of flavor strength, this is way up from my first whiskey. Off the nose, you actually get a ton of that sherry influence. So normally when you nose a Lafroig, I mean, you know it's a Lafroy. You just get a blast of peat and smoke and charred tar. Off this, you get a lot of fruit, you know, a lot of that sweet sherry. And I feel like reminds me of why I got this bottle. It's this really interesting, complex combination of the sherry characteristics, but with that classic Lafroy, briny, smoky, peaty. And I feel like the two kind of offset each other really nicely. So instead of being blasted in the face with tar and smoke, you get that briny, intense smoke characteristic, and then right away you get, you know, tons of fruit, and then it finishes salty and dry. So it's just a myriad of different flavors going on here. I mean, it's so full flavored. It just dominates the palate, coats your palate really nicely. Yeah, just an outstanding dram.
excuse me. Yeah, this is quite nice, and I could see why you picked up a bottle of this. Just off of a couple of sips, I would I would put this on my wish list as well. Definitely got that. It's leather up front. excuse me. And there's a little bit of sweetness in there. There's a little bit of almost like a pineapple. Kind of note in here, and that does say that in the notes, but they say singed pineapple. I'm not going to get that specific, but a little bit of tropical fruit note in there. But that briny finish for me, kind of salty on the finish, it really does dominate the palate, much like you're saying with yours, and I imagine when I get to yours, I'm going to feel the same way. But the leather components in the two really seem to mirror each other in a way that is really, really pleasant. that the briny finish on the scotch is almost like a palate cleanser in a way that gets me ready for the next puff of the cigar. So I feel like when I get that that puff of the cigar, I'm really going to get those leather notes. It's getting that spicy touch again, and the richness in this Aquitaine's kind of kicked up a notch as well. Kind of mirror the richness of this particular dram here. This Cowboy's Delight is legit, man. This is this is a real nice pairing. This is, I need to be sitting in my leather chair with the fire going in the library with all the leather bound books on the wall that I've never read, but they're up there anyway. And just talking about stocks or something while I'm doing this, because this is some highbrow business right here.
So Bob Dog in our chat, thanks for giving us some info. Bob Dog says, a Conker is the seed of the horse chestnut. So it's a reddish brown, almost like a Rosado wrapper color. And when you held up your glass, I would definitely agree. It's got that deep brown red color to it.
Yeah, perfect. Thanks, Bob.
I mean, and again, just so that people know, these whiskeys are not colored. The thing about a single cask is that the cask is untouched. That color is completely from the influence of the wood. And that tells you just how much the wood has been influencing that whiskey, which you can't necessarily say sometimes when you buy a whiskey, because they can add color to the whiskey to change it. But in this case, it's all natural. I'm getting a little bit of lavender from the whiskey. Now, I'm not a huge fan of lavender in my whiskey, but it's so subtle. And what's so funny is that this whiskey is so full-bodied, so dominant, that it's actually bringing a ton of sweetness out of the cigar. I would almost think this cigar is medium-bodied, like a medium-bodied Cameroon sweet cigar, because the whiskey is just so strong. But it's interesting because it brings out characteristics in the cigar that I, you know, wasn't getting with the first whiskey that I tried.
It's funny, I added a little bit of water. I haven't taken a sip yet, but and it, just on the nose, like I'm getting a lot of peach notes, which weren't anywhere near anything before. we don't reference peach in here at all. But that's definitely what I'm getting on the nose now after adding just a little bit of water.
And that's all going to be the sherry influence, and I think sherry tends to be one of my favorite casks to finish a whiskey in. Or age a whiskey. And the problem, of course, is that sherry casks are so unbelievably expensive that you see them being used less and less. And usually when you see a sherry cask used, it's a refill because, you know, they just can't afford to get a first fill sherry cask. It's just too much expense.
That's too bad, because I love that sherry cask, man. it's funny, those pineapple notes really jump out now that I put some water in there. You're still getting that leather, you're still getting that briny finish, but there's that bright tropical pineapple fruit flavor in the middle there. I actually like it better before I added the water, and I didn't add, I mean, just a couple of drops, not much. If I had a little eyedropper, it could have been more precise, but, still, I think this is probably going to be my favorite pairing of the night.
Well, really, we've got a lot of whiskeys to go through. So I'm actually, believe it or not, going down in age, but up in strength. So my third is the 127.38, which we already talked about, which is the enticing fume of a peat reek. that tells you exactly what we're in store for. Now, this is the Hita. It's 66.3%. So if you think about it in terms of bourbon, it's like 1.4 times as strong as your typical bourbon. That's crazy. I'm going to read the bottle because it's so awesome. Sweet smoke, pork cracklings, honey and soy sauce, oily mackerels and germaline. The taste is huge. A peat fire blazing in a croft house. Water releases herbal aromas of fish stock and the taste of Mediterranean pork with sage plumes and oven roasted tomatoes rolled in herbs. This is, of course, the 127, which I've completely forgot. I've forgotten the distillery entirely.
I can. I'll pull it up.
I'm pretty sure it's Port Charlotte. It's Port Charlotte or Claudia, I think. At any rate, it was distilled in August of 2003. The color is honeycomb. I'll just hold it up. It's the darkest of all the whiskeys I've got tonight. So you can see that's a lot of cask influence there. It's only 10 years old, believe it or not, but it is a refill sherry butt. So that's where you're getting that color from, is from the sherry. It's oily, and they describe it as heavily peated. And believe it or not, this is only my third whiskey. I've got a whiskey that I've got coming after this, which I think is going to be quite a bit stronger.
So I want to talk a little bit, because I've got this one as well, and I was going to do this one now before the Laphroaig, even though you just did the Laphroaig. So take a couple of sips and let me know which order I should do them in. I'll go back because I didn't actually reference the distillery that was connected to each of the whiskeys that I had before. So the 125, the Clean Innocent, which was the first one that I had, was Glenmorangie. And the 27, which was the the Happy Cowboy, or what was it? Cowboy's Delight. That is from Springbank. And I'm not familiar with Springbank, but I wasn't familiar with anything really from Campbelltown. Although my wife's last name, her maiden name was Campbell, so maybe I should be more familiar with it. But that's where that's from. The 29 that John just had is Laphroaig, and the one that he's having now is Port Charlotte. Those are the four that I'm going to be tasting as well. So which one should I do first? Should I do the Port Charlotte or the Laphroaig?
I would do the Port Charlotte. It's quite a bit sweeter, believe it or not. Okay. Now, one thing to mention is this is actually from a closed distillery. Now, they listed as Port Charlotte Bruichladdich, so I'm not actually sure if it's Bruichladdich or Port Charlotte. I'm assuming it's got to be Bruichladdich because Port Charlotte is closed. Tons of sherry influence off of this. I mean, you know, they say it's heavily peated, and it is. You can definitely get tons of peat, but again, it's balanced out with this huge sherry influence. So you get this initial smoke peat in the face, and then that's immediately run over by this super sweet melon and strawberry and banana. And it's, I mean, for a 10-year-old whiskey, we can talk about this in a different show, but for a 10-year-old whiskey, oh my God, like it's just unbelievable. Just huge, huge flavor.
It's funny. I just took my first sip, and I will admit I did put, cause this is the one that's 66.3%. I did put a little bit of water in to begin with, before we started the show. Tiny, tiny bit. But I've never had a whiskey that is so peaty up front and then rolls over into those sweet melon and fruit notes, that sherry cask influenced flavor like you're talking about. I've never experienced that in one whiskey before. It's so bold up front, and then to have it just roll into that sweet fruity notes and close on a little bit of peat, but it closes really smooth actually for 66%, surprisingly smooth.
And you know, I've had quite a few drams that are in the 60%+ range, and I have to say that you think, oh my God, 60%, like it's going to burn my face off, and sometimes it does. But I've had an equal number of whiskeys like this one where you taste it and you're like, ah, I'd put that around 56 to 58, and then you look at the bottle and you go, 66? How is this 66? It does have a ton of brine on it though, like. You know, with that initial taste of peat, there's tons of brine. And I actually think this whiskey is probably, believe it or not, a little bit too much for the cigar. It's so full-bodied. I'm not even sure what cigar you could pair with this. I'm not even sure you could find a good pairing because it's too much.
I was actually going to say the same thing. I took a puff of the cigar and I was like, wow, this is like medium now. Like this is so easy to handle now because in by comparison, and wow, if this Laphroaig is hotter than this, I don't know what I'm going to be able to do. But one thing I wanted to point out, this is kind of off topic, but we've got a follower, and he's on Instagram. His name's Ryan Atkins, and he always posts pairings and tags us in there. And I know that you've commented on some of this stuff too. He's got a nice pairing going. He's watching. This is in honor of episode 50 of sharing our pairings. He's smoking a dirty rat, and he's pairing it with the prairie bomb tonight and some dark chocolate. So that seems like that's a pretty nice
great setup. Pairing.
So Ryan, thank you for supporting the show. I appreciate that. Anyway, just get back to our regular programming here. This is, it's funny when you were telling me about this one, and I'm looking, I'm like, man, I'm just not going to like this. This is really good.
It's really good.
I'm surprised at have it be. It's when you smoke one of those cigars like Aroma Craft that's got so much strength to it, and it's intimidating in a way, but there's so much flavor in there as well, and you're almost surprised by how much flavor you get in there because there's so much strength, and there's you look at it, it's like 66%, man, that it's like you said, it's gonna burn your face off, but this has so, and there's like delicate flavors in there too. It's such a surprise and kind of like a paradox for me that I'm having trouble wrapping my mind around it, but I really do enjoy it. It is running over the cigar, so I'm probably going to move on to my next pairing, but it's quite good.
Yeah, I'll definitely be coming back to the Squissy in our After Dark segment, because unfortunately it is too much for the cigar. It's probably too much for any cigar. The sad thing about this whiskey is that you could find yourself going through half a bottle of this without much trouble, and that would be...
and then you're in trouble.
You'd be in big trouble, yeah.
Yeah, it's too easy to drink, man, when it's that. I mean, I've had some beers... you know, an Imperial IPA or a double IPA or an Imperial Stout or something, where you're drinking it, you're like, yeah, this is so good. And you look down, it's like 15%. And you think, wow, I could have a few of those and just have some issues. I mean, you go through a bomber, excuse me, of 22%, or a bomber 22 ounces at 15%, and then you're going to start feeling it. But the same thing with this. I mean, this is 66, and if I had, you know, a nice dram and then, you know, feel like, oh, maybe I'll have another one. The night's still young. By the end of that, you're toasted. And we don't condone that here on Sharing Our Pairings.
Drink better, drink less. So I'm going to go on to my fourth whiskey while I'm still coherent and not completely slurring my words, which it's coming. This is 53.184 Fairground on the Beach. So Party on the Beach. That should tell you everything you need to know about this whiskey. This is distilled in July of 1993. The color is bullion gold. So I'll hold that up without dropping it. So bullion gold. You can see it's got that kind of, you know, it's like straw spun gold. It's 19 years old. It is a refill bourbon butt, as most whiskeys are. It's Islay. It's heavily peated. And this is, I don't know if I said it, it's Cool Islay, which I always struggle with the pronunciation. It's spelled C-A-O-L-I-L-A, Cool Islay. And this is 60.4%. Now, this is my last one because I've had a bunch of whiskeys from them and I know that they are very, very peaty. You know, typically in the past when I've had a normal release, they're kind of on the lines of tar and, you know, that smell in the summertime when they're tarring the road, you know, that's the smell you typically get. Now, when I smell this, I don't get that. It's deceptive. You get lots of vanilla, oak, a little bit of heather. And I know that's not what I'm going to get when I taste it. This is going to be just a blast of peat and smoke in my face. But, you know, it's nice that the nose sort of deceives you a little bit before you taste it, because otherwise you might be a little delayed in trying to taste it.
So for my purposes, I'm going with the 29150. That John just had, that is from the Laphroaig, 22-year-old candy floss on the fairground is what they're calling it, 55.8%. John went over all this. Vibrant cadmium gold is what we're dealing with here. Much lighter in color than the last two that I've had. But that peat, man, when you want peated whiskey, Laphroaig, like, it's hard to beat Laphroaig. With the peated whiskey, and there's some others that we've talked about. You know, the Lagavulin, which Lag 16 is probably my favorite whiskey at this moment, and it's so cheap at Costco, it just blows me away. My wife picked me up a bottle for Christmas. I was very excited about that because the bottle that John, that you and I split, that bottle's long gone, and I've got a fresh one that I haven't even cracked open yet. But this isn't really on par from a peat standpoint with other Laphroaigs that I've had.
Not at all.
And maybe it's because of the heater that we just had, and my palate has just got a little bit jacked and is trying to come back around. I'm having some water, but it's more along the lines of like an Oban almost to me. It's peated, but it's not heavily peated. At least that's the feeling that I'm getting.
I mean, I think, well, it is peated, but because of the influence of the cask they're using, you know, it offsets a lot of peat. So the prominent character isn't the peat. And I think that's what, again, makes it so interesting to get these single casks, is you get a product from a distillery you know really, really well because you've drank a lot of their bottles, and you can taste that character, but it's a unique product. It's the flavor you're used to, but it's different. And I like that. Just to clarify, so the cask you're drinking is 150. The one that I was drinking was 115. So this, the 150 is a different cask. So you're going to get a different experience than I am, which is, again, kind of the fun in the different bottlings.
So how many bottles do you get out of a cask? I think we've gone over this before, but I'm just curious.
It depends. I mean, like you look at typical bottles. So this last one, for example, they only got 505 bottles. So normally, you'd probably get triple that, maybe 1,500, 1,200, 1,500 bottles when you bring it down to 43%. The 127.38, you get 618 bottles. In the 29.115, which is the earlier cask, 617 bottles.
So there's 617 bottles that come out of each cask.
In this case, yes, because they're full cask strength. They're not watering them down, so they're getting a much reduced bottling out of this, and that's what raises the price. Because they're obviously, we talk about pretty old whiskey here. They're not able to get as many bottles out of it as they normally would if they bring it down to 43 or 48 or even 40.
So this is just for my clarification now. This 29.115, that's cask 115. Does that mean they did 115 casks of it?
So that means that this is the 115th time that the Scotch and malt whiskey, so this is the 115th time they've bottled a cask from Laphroaig. So there's been 114 casks before that. Now, what's really fun, and I've got a couple in my collection, is you can get 115, and then a couple months later, you get 116, and you go, oh, God, I got to have 116 because 115 was so good, but maybe 116 isn't the same. Maybe it's not as good. Maybe you don't like it as much. Every cask is different, and that's what the whiskey makers struggle with, is that when you vat or when you age a whiskey product, you have to vat different casks to get back to that core flavor that they're used to. So when you talk about a quarter cask, they're constantly having to play with every year's release to get that flavor that everyone knows. You can't just automatically reproduce it. The wood's different, the spirit's a little bit different, the wheat's going to be a little bit, the barley's going to be a little bit different. So every year it's a little bit different. In this case, every single cask is a unique experience. Even with, between the 115 and the 116, they're different experiences. Even though it's only one cask different, it's a different cask, it's a different experience.
Interesting. So it's almost like a, there's some corollaries there to the cigar industry, in the sense that if you get, that you always, people talk about, one cigar that I always remember that everybody talked about, well, this, when they came out with this one particular year, they were great. The next year, they were not so good. Was the Rocky Patel decade, when I first started smoking cigars. That was one of the big cigars that was out. And that first year that I was smoking them, I can't remember what year this was, they were phenomenal. I really, really liked that cigar. And then when they came out the next year, they had a slightly different band or something. And the crop of tobacco is different, obviously. And it wasn't quite as good. So you're talking about kind of the same type of thing. Almost like with wine, you're talking about the same, like, vintages and everything.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Changes from year to year. So before we get into our next break here, the Coulolet that I'm tasting, this is definitely the peatiest of all the whiskeys I've tried, but it's strange to say that it's not the most full-bodied. It's not blasting me away with flavor. I'm getting a lot of peat up front, and then it kind of goes away. So in a way, it is pairing really well with the cigar because it's not blowing away the profile of the cigar. And again, what's interesting to me is that this is such a full-bodied, full-flavored cigar, and yet the whiskey is more full-flavor, more full-bodied than the cigar. So I'm getting a lot of character out of the cigar that I maybe wouldn't otherwise get. So I'm getting, again, I think a lot more nuttiness, sweetness out of the cigar that I wasn't picking up previously. Unlike the third pairing, this fourth pairing works really well. Perhaps it's not the best pairing, but I'm enjoying it, and I think ultimately that's kind of the key of our show is doing a pairing that you enjoy.
Yeah, having moved on, excuse me, from that 127, which was just, it was epically good, but it's just epic in every sense, so it was hard to get any other flavor out of anything. Had some water, calmed down a little bit, and I'm starting to get that richness back from the Aquitaine here. Nice richness, that leather, those leathery notes are coming back, even some of that spice is coming back. And with this Laphroaig, peaty up front, it's almost a similar flavor experience to the one that I had before, the 127, but toned down. It's not as epic. It's not as in your face. It starts with that peat up front, but then it rolls over. You're getting that sherry cask influence, like we were saying last time, and you get some of those sweeter notes afterwards, a little kind of like sweeter undertone there. And it's
so you are drinking the 29.115 then?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
No, 150.
Oh, 150. Okay, this is 150. That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm saying in comparison to the 127, mm-hmm. which was the big heater. This one, it's got some of those. It starts off peaty up front, but then it smooths out more so than you normally would expect from a Lafroy. So it introduces a lot more sweet characteristics that you're getting from that sherry, the sherry cask in there. So it's bringing out, like I said, some more nuance in the cigar. So I think this is a far better pairing than the 127. Not quite as good as that Cowboy's Light. That's kind of a perfect pairing here.
Yeah, it's a special bottle. Just a reminder to our audience that you are tuned in to Sharing Our Pairings, episode 50. It's a celebration, FedHeads. We are broadcast live around the world and on the Armed Forces Radio Network. Thanks very much for all the Armed Forces Radio Network listeners out there. Appreciate you guys staying safe. As Rob always says, you guys are skilled and doing stuff that we can't do. We're not equipped to do. All we're doing is drinking and smoking cigars. You are the ones that are out there keeping us safe, and we appreciate that, especially over this holiday season. Hope you all are staying safe and enjoy your New Year's. I mean, it's been an interesting selection of whiskeys. You've had a much more diverse range of whiskeys because you've started out with a Glenmorangie. You've done the Springbank. By the way, it's not surprising you haven't heard of Springbank. Springbank for many, many years was only doing whiskey to be put into what do I mean to say? In blends, yeah. But Springbank makes fantastic whiskey, and I really, really enjoy pretty much everything from Springbank, especially I think they've got a 12 cask strength that's just outstanding. They've got a 15 sherry cask, which is just, it's the color of blood. And I think I need to bring that down at some point because it's just so sherry. It's like the most sherry next to maybe the Amaret Intermediate Sherry. I think it's the most sherried whiskey. Just so good.
Now, is the Springbank stuff, they're the ones that, are they closed? Is that the one you were talking about?
No, Port Charlotte is closed, but you know, on the decoding page for the Scotch and Malt Whiskey Society, it says Port Charlotte Bruichladdich, and it's got to be Bruichladdich because Port Charlotte's been closed for many years. So this is all Bruichladdich casks, and I'm very familiar with Bruichladdich. I've got a lot of their bottles. They're very, very good. But again, what's so great about all of these products is they're even from a distiller you know really well, you're getting a different product that you would otherwise get.
Yeah, that's the concept is really, really cool. I don't think they have it here in the States. It seemed when I was trying to log into the website, it was it's Canada-based, yeah?
Not at all. There's a Scotch Malt Whiskey Society. I think they're in every major country. So in Europe, they're in America, they're in Canada. So if you want to go to the U.S. site and check it out, it's SMWS.com for the American site, SMWS.ca for the Canadian site, and then some other site for Europe. I don't know, but
I was going to this. I was clicking through your links, which was the Canadian site. Mm-hmm. That's because it was asking me what province I'm in. I'm like, well, I'll be in Alberta. What the hell? That was what I went with. I chose Alberta.
Freedom.
Yeah. Why not? This is probably the second best pairing for me tonight. I'll have to go back to that Cowboy's Delight, which
it's such a great bottle.
And that was from Cowboy. Was from that's Springbank. That's what we talked about. Okay, so Springbank, and they're still around. I'm gonna have to look for some of their bottles because
they have really, really good stuff. We got a couple of minutes left before we close out our Armed Forces Radio Network segment here. So maybe we can get some questions here. We've got a couple of questions from Jeff Madre. Jeff, thanks very much for putting in your questions. He's always big on asking questions in our pairing show, and we appreciate that. So first up, and this is kind of a big overreaching question, he wants to know what the most enjoyable pairing that each of you experienced during this year's episodes of SOP. I'm going to throw Rob under the bus and say, Rob, what was your most enjoyable pairing this year?
You know, I don't know. I feel like I have some great enjoyable pairings, at least one or two every show. The one that I'll go back to, and it's the one that surprised me the most, and we've talked about this before, is when we did the Smoking Monk Bestiali series from Drew Estate, and we did the IPA show.
IPA show.
And, you know, I can't even remember which IPAs I had. it was a long time ago. But that was one of my more enjoyable shows because I expected I expected the pairings to just be horrible. And it was a good learning experience for me because I've paired a lot with IPA since then. And I found some that were great and I found some that were not so good at all. But that's probably the one that sticks in my mind the most. So I'm skirting the question a little bit. I don't know what my favorite one was, but that's the one that popped to mind first when I read that question.
And I'm going to be a homer here and agree with you. That was, to me, and Jeff asked a second question here, which was what pairing this year was much better or much worse. And, I think the two kind of go hand in hand. The IPA show really surprised me, I think, going into the Smoking Monk series. We did, I think, 5 cigars. That was the one that I don't want to say dreading, but I was anticipating it not to work out as well. And it ended up being one of the best. I think what we took away from that is that, we need to start looking at maybe like the Sam Lucia to try and get some more fire-cured tobacco and try and pair that with IPAs, because I think fire-cured tobacco and IPAs go really well. And maybe if we get into some Kalanox in the new year, that might be an interesting cigar to pair up with IPAs, which is not something I normally would have tried to pair, because IPAs are just, it's like a sour. It's just such a different flavor from the normal beer lineup. You kind of don't expect it to go really well with a bunch of stuff.
And the Kalanaw you're referring to is the Hammer and Sickle it's got 25% of the filler tobacco is peat fire cured.
Which I think is a really interesting concept, and we've talked about this in previous shows. That I love as a tobacco nerd, I love to see people pushing sort of the comfort zone of the industry to say, when people have used San Andreas, Maduro, Negra as a wrapper or as a binder instead of a wrapper, and you go, but that's like the predominant wrapper, and they go, no, I'm going to use it as a binder instead. And I love seeing people play with stuff like that and come out with a concept that's different than what everyone else is doing, and just pushing that envelope, whether it works or doesn't. That's fun. It's fun to see people sort of, try and extend out what's being done in the industry.
Absolutely. I would agree with that completely. And what was the other half of his question was, what was one that didn't work out so well?
Yeah, that was the second part of his question, is what pairing was kind of much worse than you expected.
For me, it was the Hot Chocolate Show. You weren't there for that. When Aaron Loomis and I did that show, and we did all of our hot chocolates were milk based, so they were thicker, and it really was kind of that thick coating your palate, which you don't think about when you're drinking it, but when you're trying to pair it with something else and introduce new flavors while you're drinking it, it's almost impossible without taking a couple of sips of water in between. So that was kind of a bummer, because it just seems like coffee is such a no brainer pairing. I felt like hot chocolate would be on par with that, and I think that we'd probably do a little bit better if we did some water based hot chocolates. Just the real simple stuff, that just you pop a little cup into your Keurig and make some Swiss Miss or something. I wonder if that would pair a little bit better, but the stuff that we did was a little bit more, it was a bit richer, it was a bit thicker, it was a bit more luxurious, if you will. And it just made it almost impossible to taste the cigars. And, it made for a difficult show, because we're doing 4 or 5 pairings and you want to talk about everything, and it's just tough when the pairings just don't do anything, for what you're doing. So, that was the most difficult one for me.
Yeah, I think, sadly, we kind of threw Aaron under the bus a couple times, because Aaron and I did a show with the hard ciders, and unfortunately, very, very tough to pair with the hard ciders.
Cameroon, baby.
It didn't go with anything, and, I know we've avoided Gozes and Sours, and I think part of the reason we've done that in my mind is because I'm not quite confident that any cigar is really going to go with that, because it's just such a different flavor. It's not even a contrasting flavor. It's just so outside the flavor maps for cigars that I'm not sure anything is really going to go well with it. It pairs with cheese, it pairs with meat, but with a cigar, I'm just not sure. And unfortunately, the hard cider is just way outside the realm of what worked, I'm afraid.
Yeah, I can see that being an interesting show, interesting on the bad end. It seems like when you just pull out those fruity notes, it's going to be tough to pair with. But I'd be curious to do a sour show. But I
you
just
don't, yeah, I mean, I do it just because we haven't done it, and I think it'd be interesting. I found some sours locally here that or at least that are being sold in the smaller bottles. So instead of being, you know, $15-16 a bottle, they're down around the $8-9, which is kind of where we're landing with a lot of the stouts and stuff. So yeah, I mean, we haven't done it, so we might as well, I think.
Yeah, what the hell. So we're coming up to the end of our AFRN segment here.
We are. We got about 2 minutes left. So one thing I'd just like to say is I appreciate all of our listeners who have tuned in over the last year. You know, we've been doing this show since 2014. And although I don't think we're the first to do pairing, I think we're probably the first that is dedicated to pairing. And, you know, one of the interesting things for me is that now I see all these magazines and I see all these sites that have really picked up pairing. You know, even Cigar Aficionado has just recently done a pairing where they've got recommended pairings with cigar and liquor. And I don't think that's something you would have seen back in 2014, definitely not in 2013. And of course, we talked this year about the DRAM pairings, the DRAM cigar. We talked about the Drew Estate Smoking Mug series. And it's really great to see a lot of these companies come out with stuff that's meant to be paired with beverages, because ultimately, I think a lot of cigar smokers out there are not just smoking a cigar on its own. They're drinking it with a tea, they're drinking it with a beverage. So, you know, I think this show kind of hit that mark as it was hitting the popularity. And I think we've kind of ridden that as it's increased in popularity in the market.
We've got our finger on the pulse, man.
That's right.
Absolutely.
So I just want to say thank you very much for everyone who's tuned in. Certainly all the people that have tuned in since we started our show back in 2014, all the people that have tuned in for 2015, appreciate you watching and listening to our show. Wherever you're listening, we don't really care. We just appreciate you listening in. You can always drop a line to either john@cigarfederation.com or rob@cigarfederation.com. We love hearing your feedback. I know we've got a lot of people that interact with us on social media, and we appreciate that. Hopefully we'll have some really cool stuff coming up in 2016. You know, we're trying to hope to lock down Hammer and Sickle with the Kalanok in February, which I think would be a really cool show. You know, Eric's got a background in spirits. That's kind of where his background is. So I think he's a great guy to have on the show. And, you know, we're going to aim to have some more cigar celebrities on the show, like Fred from Nomad. And who knows? We're going to have some interesting guests, I think, coming up in 2016. Any parting words there, Rob?
No, does everybody have a happy new year, and we'll catch you on the flip side.
Here you go, everybody out there. Stay safe. And of course, as we're coming up on New Year's, make sure you make smart decisions for New Year's. Don't want to see anyone out there drink and drive. I know you kind of get hit with that along the radio, but it's a big deal. We don't want anyone out there making bad decisions. Take an Uber, take a cab, do something other than drink and drive, because you got to drink better and drink less. And we're back.
Man, my throat is bugging me today.
Yeah, you're a trooper, man. You've been feeling under the weather for a week, and you just hopped in for our 50th show, and you're like, fuck it, I'm gonna do this super crazy tear-me-up cigar and cask-strength whiskey. I don't care.
Hey, if you're going to get wet, you may as well swim, right?
That's right.
So a couple of things. Today in the chat room, Stefan suggested a George Thorogood show where we do one bourbon, one scotch, and one beer, and we pair all those with one particular cigar.
That sounds fun.
And then that got me thinking we could do a Chumbawamba show with a whiskey drink and a vodka drink and whatever, however else the song goes. You know the Chumbawamba? No?
I do know the Chumbawamba. That comes from my my era.
Yeah, there you go. And so we could do some song-based shows and see what happens.
Yeah.
We haven't done anything like that where we've done, or maybe we have, where we've done like a bourbon, a scotch, and then a beer with one particular cigar. I'd be curious to see how that worked out.
I think the most we've ever done is we've done a bourbon and like a whiskey show where we've mixed it up with scotch whiskey and then bourbon, American whiskey. But I don't think we've ever really gone crazy where we've done like rum whiskey or rum bourbon and beer, or, you know, I'm positive we've never done bourbon and beer before. So that would be interesting. I mean, in my mind, I think what would be cool is doing bourbon and then a bourbon-based or bourbon-aged beer.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think that'd be kind of cool.
Yeah, barrel aged stuff, yeah.
I actually just had, I was at a Christmas party or Christmas get together with my girlfriend's family. And one of the guys brought a Brewster's bourbon aged stout. And, you know, I love the bourbon aged stouts. And this thing, I had it before dinner. I think it was like 11.9%. And it's so good. It's just, it's so bourbony, but not so bourbony that it runs over all the stout characteristics. And it was kind of one of those things where I tasted it and I immediately went, cha-ching, this gets added to my buy list because this is going to be, I don't know if it's going to be on a show, but, you know, that's going to be in my rotation because it's so good.
What was it called?
You know, it's like it was a very simple name. It was just Brewster's like bourbon aged stout.
Brewster.
Yeah, they're. I'm pretty sure they're a distiller, or a brewery out of Calgary or out of Banff.
Huh.
But yeah, I'm gonna be going to my local haunt probably tomorrow or on the weekend and see if I can get some of those bottles and try it out. But yeah, I think, you know, we've done 50 shows. We've done a lot of different stuff. I think one of the interesting ones to get back to would be tea. We've only done one tea show and I kind of did that with Logan because Logan is the tea master. And I really enjoyed that. That was actually a really fun show. We did a couple different weird teas, which I had never tried before. And I'm not really a tea drinker, but that was a fun show to try. A beverage that's non-alcoholic but has all of this layers and layers of complexity with cigars. And, you know, there's a lot of our listeners out there who are not alcoholic drinkers. So that's kind of a cool show for me.
Yeah, there's a lot of tea out there. It's a whole like, almost, I don't want to say subculture. I don't know if it's the right term or not. But there's just a ton of it out there that I know nothing about. Nothing.
Yeah,
I mean, I like tea, and I mean, like English breakfast or something like that. You know, some Earl Grey, I'll tear it up. But I don't know enough about like the kind of, where you get like the big tea ball and you put it in there and it opens up and let's, you know, whatever. I don't know. It all looks like pot when you put it in a bag to me. So.
Yeah, my girlfriend is super huge into tea. She's got like a whole bunch of infusers and different pots and stuff. And I guess it's a little bit like pipe tobacco where you're really only supposed to use one type of tea in a particular pot because otherwise it adds flavor to the pot. So this is, I mean, there's a lot of layers to it. I feel like, you know, it's been a couple of weeks since we've done any NFL stuff. And I feel like, you know, this is the last coming up in the last regular season week of the year. And I feel like we'd be remiss not to get our picks in. Well, how do you feel about that?
Yeah, let's do it. You're the one out in the cold, man. I've got a heater.
I don't care. It doesn't matter to me.
Let's commit.
So, of course, I am hanging on by a thread. I got crushed in our fantasy football league. I'm going to go be a homer and say I had so many injuries, and I was doing really well at the start of the season and just plagued by injuries. And unfortunately, I just finished really weak, and I think I finished like fourth or fifth in the league, which is better than I was expecting. But in my pick'em pool, I have been leading all season long. And last week, I kind of gave up a bit of the lead because someone picked the Colts, and the Colts came out with a big win, which eroded my lead. So I'm really only leading, I think, by 2 points going to week 17. And I got to say, you know, it's not about winning, but boy, I'd sure be pissed off if I lost the entire year in week 17 by my picks.
Yeah, fantasy kind of screwed me. I dominated through the regular season and won the regular season points total.
Nice. Congratulations.
Finished second in the regular season because I lost to Hilk and his watch AP Nene was his team name or something like that. He beat me, so we had the same record, but since he beat me, he won. He came in first place. And then I dropped it in the second round of the playoffs, man. I benched my boy Danny Woodhead.
Oh.
Had scored, I mean, I'll only go on this for a second. Week 11, 1 point. Week 12, 9. Week 13, 6. Week 14, 3. And throughout the whole season, he was averaging like 18 points a game. And he was a little up and down, but, you know, he had some big games. And so after, you know, 4 weeks of just not being very good, and really 7 weeks of not being very good, mixing one good game in there, he blew up for 36 points that week. Had I played him, I would have won, and I would have come in second. But since I didn't, I came in fourth, and that's kind of a bummer.
Yeah, that's a bummer.
But what are you going to do? I didn't have the injuries that everybody else had. But my guys let me down last week for sure. So we're done there, and the 49ers suck, so we can move on.
So I'm obviously riding the high of Fitzmagic, who we talked a little bit about that on our recap show on Cigar Chat. The Jets pulled out just a miraculous win. A large part of that was the Patriots making a baffling decision in overtime to kick the ball, which I'm sure will be discussed for weeks to come. And I really don't know what they were thinking, but it is what it is, and Fitzmagic came through with a huge TD win and put us in playoff contention, especially with the Steelers losing. So, you know, this is week 17. We've got a lot of games to go through, so I'm just going to crack a lack here. First game up on the board is the Saints versus the Falcons. And I think it's going to be a really interesting matchup because the Falcons, I was really high on the Falcons at the start of the season, and they really crapped the bed. And what's interesting is Drew Brees is back, although, you know, the question is whether he's back at full strength or not. And this is a divisional matchup, and the Falcons played really, really good ball last week to knock off a divisional rival. So, you know, I'm really not sure what to think about that, but it's a home game for the Falcons, and based on the performance last week, I feel like I got to take the Falcons.
Yeah, I don't know what the hell to make of the Falcons. And I mean, they're kind of on the edge of making the playoffs, aren't they?
They are.
They control their own destiny, it looks like, for that last playoff spot in the NFC, right?
And that's a dangerous place to have a team.
They have to. If they win, they're in the playoffs. Yep. And if they lose, they better win. I'll take the Falcons. Yeah, there's a lot riding on that game.
So, next up is a classic divisional matchup. Especially, you'd love to see this in Week 17. I feel like this is a game that should be flexed into Sunday night, but probably won't be. It's the New York Jets going to Buffalo to face off against their ex-coach, Rex Ryan, and the Buffalo Bills. And this is a must-win game for the Jets, who have been, I think they've won the last six games in a row. They just finished beating the Patriots. And the risk here is that you let your foot off the gas, and especially a divisional opponent like the Buffalo Bills, who are going to be looking to knock them out of playoff contention. Since I went with the Jets last week against the Patriots, and I didn't know they were going to be able to pull it off, I'm definitely going to go with the Jets against the Bills. So it's a Bills home game. Jets are the guests, but I got to go with the Jets.
Yeah, the the Jets are actually 4-3 on the road. Looks like the Bills are 4-3 at home. Another team controls their own destiny. They win, they're in.
Yep.
So they're 10-5. That's kind of a surprise to me. Mm-hmm. Man, some of these divisions are just crap, though.
Terrible.
Well, yeah, I'll go with the Jets, too.
One of the interesting games, which I don't know what to make of, and I'm going to make my pick tonight, but when my pick and pull is going to be a game-time decision, is the Lions go to Chicago to face off against the Bears. Bears have been just awful all season. And the Lions have done really, really well. But, you know, I feel like the Bears are really dangerous at home. And I don't know what to make of this game. My gut says go with the Bears, but my football brain says you got to go with the Lions because the Lions are just – they're coming off wins. The previous matchup, the Lions just beat the hell out of the Bears. I don't know what to make of that game.
I just watched the Bears lose to the 49ers. And where are they playing?
Playing in Chicago.
The Bears are 1-6 at home this year. Mm-hmm. That's brutal. And the Lions are 2-5 on the road. So this is like the dog doo-doo bowl. And it doesn't really matter. It matters to you because you've got to pick them league. I'll probably go with the Bears just to be, contrary.
Yeah, I don't know. I may end up switching my pick to the Lions, but we'll see. That's definitely a game time choice for me. Next up, the Ravens, who just thankfully knocked off the Steelers, which is so bizarre. But they go to Cincinnati to face the Bengals. Now, the Bengals are without their great quarterback. You felt that pain in fantasy. You got knocked out with an injury. But even with the injured quarterback, he's out. they managed to put up a heck of a game last week, and I don't think Baltimore's got what it takes to knock off the Bengals.
No, in the Bengals is the Red Rider, whatever the hell his name is he going to play?
I don't think so. I thought he was out for the season, so I don't think he's back. I don't think he's going to be miraculously healed wearing a cast or anything.
I thought the word was if they get into the playoffs, he's going to come back and they're in, that he would come back in and play.
Yeah, I can't see Dalton coming back in week 17. That's got to be, they're in for sure. There's no way they're going to risk extra injury in a week 17 game when they pretty much guaranteed.
This is one of those games that's tough to call because, I mean, the Bengals have nothing to lose. The Ravens really have nothing to gain. So you don't know who's going to play all their guys. my instinct says go with the Bengals, but you never know.
The Steelers coming off a bitter loss against their divisional opponents. The Ravens face another divisional opponent, the Cleveland Browns. Cleveland actually had a good game last week, which is weird. Johnny Manziel playing decent football. I'm not sure what to make of this. I don't know whether the Steelers can get it together for this game. I don't think it matters at this point. Even if they win this game, I don't think there's any chance they can make the playoffs unless the Jets lose. I mean, my gut says go with the Steelers, but Browns at home. I mean, I don't know, man. I don't know.
You got to go Steelers all the way. There's something on the line for them. They still have a shot. They're not eliminated because the Jets haven't, clinched that spot. So the Jets lose a game. The Steelers are 10-6. The Jets are 10-6. I don't know how they figure that out. I don't know what the tiebreaker is.
The tiebreaker is if the Steelers win their game and the Jets lose the game, then the Steelers are in.
Oh, then you got to go with the Steelers, man.
Yeah.
That's the game where you have to turn it up, even though Roethlisberger was crap last week, which contributed to me coming in fourth because I had to play him. If you can't win this game with the season on the line against the Browns, although you could say that about last week when they lost to the Ravens, so who knows? I'll go Steelers.
I think this is an easy pick. The Redskins go to Dallas to face off against the Cowboys. Redskins are going to crush them. It's a no-brainer pick. I don't think I need to say anything more about that.
But the Redskins won their division.
Yeah, they killed it.
That's so funny.
So sad.
I mean, they're 8-7. They're over 500. God bless them. The Cowboys are – the Cowboys and the 49ers are just hanging out together because they both suck.
Yep.
That's really all there is to it.
So Redskins?
Yeah, absolutely. Sorry.
Okay. Jacksonville Jags go to Houston to face off against the Texans. I feel like Texans at home, it's got to be a Texans win.
God, that's a bad division too. Yeah, I mean, the Texans have to win.
Yeah.
They got to win they win the division. So, I like the Jags. I think they're one of those teams. They've only got 5 wins in the season, but I feel like they're pointed in the right direction. Even though I don't watch that much of their football, I feel like their offense, their guys, their wide receivers are always scoring a ton of points in fantasy. Mm-hmm. So they must be doing something right on offense. Their defense, I think, is garbage. But, I think you're looking at that game, and the Texans have a lot of – God, the Texans, wow. They have a lot on the line to get to the playoffs. Boy, that's just – man, the AFC South, that's crap.
So terrible. Tennessee Titans go to Indianapolis to face off against the Colts. Colts came out with a big victory last week. Now they're at home. I don't know, man. I feel like I'm just going to pick the Colts because they're a home team, but I don't have a lot of confidence in that game.
I saw who these guys they're signing to play quarterback this week. And if they win, they get in the playoffs, right?
Yep.
Because they're one game. If they win and the Texans lose, I would assume that
I think they have the tiebreaker, yeah.
The Colts get in. But, I mean, these guys – let me just – bear with me a second to see
who – There's so much complexity in Week 17 with the playoff picture. Like, there's just so many scenarios with – yeah.
So, as of today, Josh Freeman and Ryan Lindley handled the lion's share of quarterback reps at Colts practice.
Wow.
That is rough, rough times. That's rough times. And if they get into the playoffs, I mean, are they even like is Andrew Luck even a chance to come back? I have no idea. So it almost just seems academic that they're going to play to get in the playoffs and then lose. Yeah, that's tough. But it's in a must-win game like that, you got to go with the team, I think, that must win.
Yeah. In the no-brainer pick of the week, this is probably the easiest pick of the week. The Patriots go to Miami to face off against the Dolphins. You know, everyone preseason was like, Dolphins, blah, blah, blah. Dolphins are perennial favorites. Whatever, man. Every year you say that. Every year the Dolphins suck. They're going to continue to suck. I'm sorry, Dolphins fans. I know you love your team, but you're going to get crushed by the Patriots in week 17. They're going to rest their starters in third quarter.
Are the Patriots the best team in the NFL?
I don't know, man. I mean, you know, it seems like they seem to be the most consistently complete team in the NFL. I don't know if they're the best, but I don't think you need to be the best. I think you need to be the most consistent. And to me, the Patriots just consistently, even like you look at their offensive line, they've lost like how many players have they lost off their offensive line? 5 guys off their offensive line. And they still managed to play all out football against the Jets, where it looked like they were going to beat the Jets. And that's with like losing every single guy off their offensive line. And they still made it a hell of a game. So, you know, against an opponent like Dolphins, it's they're going to crush them. It's going to be gross.
I mean, you got to figure though, that Brady and Gronk and those guys aren't going to see a whole hell of a lot of action.
No, they're going to get up by 3 or 4 touchdowns. And
in the first 10 minutes and then sit down for the rest of the game.
Exactly.
I'll go with you on that one. I'll go with the Patriots.
Now, in an interesting matchup, Eagles versus Giants. And, you know, you say the Eagles are a mess. They just fire Chip Kelly. But that's exactly when a team is dangerous, is when they fire their head coach. You know, I don't know what the stats are because I'm not NFL.com or ESPN.com, but I think there's some sort of rule about teams that fire their coaches come out and play huge games. And, you know, I think if it wasn't for that, I'd probably pick the Eagles over the Giants. But the Giants at home, coming off of a coach being fired on the Eagles, it's a tough game to predict. I mean, I want to go with the Giants because they're at home, but I don't know.
Yeah, that's I don't know, man. I'd be curious to see though with the Eagles, whoever their coach is now. This kind of leads back to a conversation that we had at the end of the show yesterday when we were talking about how much the coach actually matters.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'll probably go. It was the Eagles and the Giants, you said?
Yeah, in New York.
Yeah, I think you got to go with the Giants. Just. Hopefully, it would be kind of a disaster for them if they lose, don't you think?
No, I think both teams are going to miss the playoffs. Even if they do well, neither one has a chance to make the playoffs, so they're not gonna win.
Yeah, no, it just seems like if the Giants go into the offseason like that, especially in New York, it just seems like that would be a rough loss for them.
Yeah. So, interesting matchup here. The Seahawks go to Arizona face off against the Cardinals, and the Cardinals have already clinched their division. So,
they've clinched their spot too.
They have. So the Seahawks are in, the Cardinals are in. Where do you go with a game like that? You know, my gut says, just my natural instinct says you got to go with the Cardinals, but the Seahawks have been playing full out football for the last couple weeks.
The Cardinals have won 9 games in a row. Mm-hmm. I mean, you look at them, they might be the best team in football.
I honestly think they are. And I was, you know, I was earlier in the season, I was high on the Arizona Cardinals. So I was saying to me, they were pretty much a perennial lock, like either to make it to the conference game or to be the Super Bowl, the Super Bowl guys to show up. And then they had a bunch of terrible games. But since then, They keep winning. They keep winning and winning and winning. Doesn't matter how they win, they keep winning. And, you know, based on that alone, I feel like I got to play the Cardinals. But I don't know. It's going to be an interesting game to watch.
I like looking at things like, well, they're 10-1 in their conference, which I don't know who they lost to in the NFC
probably,
West.
Probably the Rams.
Yeah, the Rams did come up with a couple of random wins. But their point differential on the year – they're plus 206.
Yeah.
So they've scored 206 more points than they've given up.
Yeah.
And the next best is the Patriots at 160.
Mm-hmm.
So 206, and they've scored obviously the most points in the NFL on the season. I think the Cardinals are, they might be the best team in the NFL.
I think so. certainly the NFC.
Yeah, and I don't know if they're playing for home field advantage at this point. Carolina's 14-1, they're 13-2. I'm not sure what the tiebreaker is there, but there could be some incentive to push to have there. Although they're 6-1 at home and 7-1 on the road, so I don't know if it really matters. But anyway, yeah, I think the Cardinals are probably just the better team.
I think so. And a no-brainer pick of the week, the Buccaneers go to Carolina to face off against the Panthers. I mean, the Panthers did lose last week, and I think I called that for the record. I think I called that 3 or 4 weeks ago when we were talking about Carolina being on a no-loss season and a no-no. And I said the most dangerous team they could face in the year is the Falcons, because that's exactly the kind of team that could knock them off, and they did. They're not going to lose against the Bucs. I think that's a lock. That's a stone-cold lock of the week is the Panthers over the Bucs.
I still think it's tough, man, because, I mean, do they have a reason to keep guys on the field? It's tough. And actually, they have the second-best point differential. They're plus 164.
So, yeah, they got to win that game, though, to clinch home field advantage, right?
Yeah, well, I don't know. I mean, if they lose and the Cardinals win, then they're both, 14-2.
14-2, and I think the Cardinals might have the tiebreaker.
I have no idea. I'm just looking at the standings. So if they've got something to play for, then I think it's a no-brainer. If not, that game could get squirrely.
Yeah. San Diego goes to Denver to face off against the Broncos. We've talked about it every week. Broncos are the best worst team in the league. Broncos kind of have to win this game. I mean, you know, they're in the playoffs. They've clinched the playoff spot, but you know, the Chiefs are right on their tail. I don't know, man. You know, it's so tough in week 17 to predict how these games are going to go, but I feel like I got to take the Broncos at home.
Yeah. and to be fair, I think the worst best team, I think, is Green Bay for me. Yeah. I see Green Bay making an early exit from the playoffs. I don't know. They don't look like Green Bay. But anyway, I'll probably go with the Broncos there too.
In the Blood Bowl game of the week, the Raiders go to Kansas City, face off against the Chiefs. Again, the over-under in this game is the number of people stabbed and shot in the parking lot. Got to go with the Chiefs on this one. Chiefs have just been flat out awesome. And I think, you know, we talk about who the best team is. I don't think they're the best team in the AFC, but I think they might be the most dangerous team going to the playoffs. They're in. And I would hate to be the guy that has to face him in the first round and the second round, because, you know, dangerous, dangerous team.
Well, they could still win their division, I think.
They could. If
Broncos lose and they win, they're tied. I don't know who has the tiebreaker. But, they've won 9 in a row. And I remember at the beginning of the season we were talking about, man, the Chiefs are losing all these games where we think they should be winning. And they've turned around and figured it out.
Chiefs have the divisional win record, and they have the conference win record. So I feel like if the Chiefs win and the Broncos lose, Chiefs win their division.
Yeah, and the Broncos and the Chiefs feel like two teams with very similar records that might be going in different directions. The Chiefs seem to be – they're definitely trending up.
Yep.
So, yeah, you got to go with the Chiefs there, because they've got something to play for. They've got something to win.
And again, I'm going to call them as the most dangerous team in the playoffs this season, the Kansas City and the AFC. I mean, I'd hate to be the Patriots and face off against the Chiefs, because that's the exact kind of team that could knock the Patriots off early in the playoffs.
Yeah.
In the no-brainer pick of the week, the Rams on the road against the 49ers. Sorry, 49ers fans. 4-11 season, facing off against the Rams, who just seems to have everybody number this year. You know, they've got a 4-1 divisional record. It's the Rams are going to kill the 49ers.
Yeah, I'm hoping for the Niners are 0-5 in division. I'm just hoping for losses at this point. And everybody talks about they'll get one of those high picks and let's take a quarterback. No, take the best offensive lineman and then clone him like four times, because their offensive line is crap. And it doesn't matter who your quarterback is when you have no offensive line. Unless you're in New England and you can just you know, use duct tape and these weird guys that you've never heard of who come in and play well. But you know, people will tell you that the coach has nothing to do with it, but I disagree. I think the Rams are going to come in and win that game. And I just hope the Niners end up with the top five pick and they get one of the best offensive linemen on the board.
The second most interesting game of the week, the game to watch. Both teams have clinched their playoff spots, but the division lead is at stake here. The Vikings on the road against the Green Bay Packers.
Ooh, that is a good game.
That's a great game.
Is that Monday night?
That's a Sunday night game. And, you know, I talked about flexing. There is really no other Sunday night game. So it's tough to flex him out of that spot because that's exactly what you want to see in a Sunday night game.
Yeah, and they've got a little bit of a rivalry there between those two teams, going back to the Brett Favre days. Also feel like two teams going in different directions. Very, very similar when you look at their record, their same record.
You know, the Vikings are 4-1 in their division, so I mean that's something.
That's a difference. Yeah, the Vikings and the Packers are 3-2. When you look at that point differential is about the same. This is a game that if the Packers plan on getting their shit together and making a run in the playoffs, they need to win this.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. That could be
the game that decides my entire year for the pick and pool.
Yeah, I feel like the Packers have a lot more to lose than the Vikings do. The Packers have been in this position. They know how to win football games. They don't look very good lately. I think if you look at this game in a vacuum, it doesn't matter where they're playing, you almost have to take the Packers. Even though I feel like their team's trending in different directions, the Packers should know how to win games like this. Do you know what I'm saying?
I do, when the pressure's on the line. But I'm going to go Vikings because I feel like Vikings have the divisional record, which means they know their opponents. The Vikings, and you can see it in their fans, the Vikings feel disrespected. They've been disrespected in the rankings. And they're going to be playing full-out football. This is a game where every single player, even though both of them have clinched the division, I feel like every single player is going to be playing all four quarters.
It's a playoff game. It's a playoff game, and I think if this were a playoff game, I think you'd have to take the Packers.
Yeah.
Just because they've been there, and I think when it comes to sports and you're talking about being under the brightest lights and the guys who have been there, I think there's something to be said for guys who they're there for the first time and they don't know any better. They're just enjoying the moment. I think there's part of that, but I think the Packers have to win this game.
So you going Packers?
Yeah, I think they got to win. They have to win this game.
It'd be interesting. I mean, it'd be great next Wednesday when we have our next pairing show to see who came out on top and what the playoff picture is, because it's going to be probably one of the more interesting playoffs in recent history.
Yeah, it's going
to
be fun.
Yeah, I can't wait to see what happens in the Super Bowl in February. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in to sharing our pairings. We'll be back next Wednesday. What's our topic? I don't know, but it'll be fun. Appreciate everyone tuning in 2015. We'll be back in 2016 with a new pairing show. Make sure to drink better, but drink less, guys.